Welcome to the Legal Learning Podcast. I'm Jolene, your host with the Legal Learning Center. I help pre-law students and law students with their legal journey. Today, we will chat with Angie, the founder of LegUp Legal. She will talk about the wide variety of ways her company provides networking and mentoring to students. After, I'll give you my top takeaways, but first, a quick word from our sponsor. Financially Free Aspiring Attorneys is a course with over $300,000 in money-saving tips. If you want to go to law school but you don't want to pay for it, visit legallearningcenter.com/financially-free for more information on how you can avoid law loans.
Thanks so much for having me, Jolene. So, hi everyone, my name is Angie Vishyanan and I am the founder of LegUp Legal. We provide a mentoring program that connects prospective law students to lawyers for mentoring so they can learn a little bit more about the legal profession before they decide whether or not law school is the right step for them. And we have been doing a whole bunch of things during COVID-19 to connect with our community, with our mentees, with our mentors, and really get to know a lot of the students and the attorneys who are participating better and what their needs are right now. So I'm super excited to talk to Jolene today because I know that she helps out a bunch of pre-law students, and I'd really love to help in any way I can.
Yeah, and you really do because you have a lot going on. LegUp Legal is just everywhere, it seems like, for everyone that needs it. So yes, I'm excited to get into this. So let's talk first about your Zoom meetups that you do on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Can you tell me a little bit about what that is and what it covers?
Absolutely. So every Tuesday and Thursday at noon Central Time, we do Zoom meetups where we use the Zoom meeting function instead of the webinar. So you're actually able to see all the other people on the meetup and you're able to see the speaker. And we bring in guest speakers who are either lawyers or law school admissions consultants or LSAT coaches or all sorts of people who are knowledgeable about areas that will help you in your legal career to come talk to the students about their career paths and what they can be doing to help their own careers. So usually it's very casual. We have about 30 to 45 minutes of the lawyer chatting with you about their journey, and then we'll do an open Q&A at the end where you actually get to interact with every attorney.
Yeah, and I definitely attended, and I got to see one that was about financial aid and loans and things like that. And it was super informative and just a wealth of information packed into that hour. So highly value the Zoom meetups. They are great, both for prospective law students, but then also, law students can definitely gain as well.
One of the best things that I like about our Zoom meetups is that the students get to meet actual current law students and young lawyers. So we usually have all three of those people join our audience. And so it's really great for people to be able to network right now and connect with each other, even during a time where we're all social distancing. So yeah, definitely come stop by, check it out.
I think that's something that LegUp Legal does. LegUp Legal really does connect people from all over, law students as well as law students and lawyers. So it's really a great service. And I've seen it. I've been a part of it, actually. The next thing I want to ask you about, I participated in this one as well, is the biweekly virtual happy hour that you do, because I still talk to the person I got to meet on that. So tell us a little bit about that.
So our biweekly virtual happy hours are every other Friday, and we wanted to have something that was more casual that people could actually get to bond with other people one-on-one. So instead of doing a guest speaker where they talk at you for 30 minutes and then we do Q&A, this time we actually invite everyone to come and give their short introduction. So you get to give a short, 2-minute introduction about yourself in the main Zoom room. And then based on those introductions, you can decide if there's people that you want to be paired up with in the breakout rooms. And we do breakout rooms one-on-one for 15 minutes. And then you come back into the main room and we switch everybody around and you do another round of breakouts for 15 minutes. So we've played around with the format a lot, but we find that, having people bond, one-to-one or maybe one-to-two is the best group to really get to know people. So we want to have in the main group, everybody gets to hear from everyone else, and then we'll do breakout rooms so that you can get to know somebody more one-on-one. Then afterwards, we all come back into the main room and each of us shares a fact that we learned about the two people that we met. So then everybody gets to hear a little more about everyone else. And we've had so many people bond with the people that they've met on our happy hour. And I love being able to see, follow everybody on LinkedIn and see how they're all interacting together. You know, many of the people who didn't even get to meet each other in breakouts, but they all got to see each other in the main introductions. They all connect with each other on LinkedIn afterwards and then do their own one-on-ones. So it's been really cool to see everybody in our community interacting.
I think the Zoom meetups are less awkward than when you go to a huge convention and you don't know anyone and you walk
in. Oh, absolutely. I mean, for me, those large networking events, you know, big bar association meetings or whatever, those are kind of my worst nightmare. You know, I'm a lot better one-on-one like this. So I think it's actually a great way for students to just ease into networking. And, you know, the nature of Zoom, especially if you're doing the breakout rooms with just one other person, you know, that's a lot less intimidating than going to a big cocktail event and you have to run around the room, get to know people, you know, thrust yourself in front of people and introduce yourself. I mean, that can be really intimidating too. So take advantage of all these virtual events for sure.
Yeah, as you said, this is a great warm up. So now what's your virtual coffee club about?
Yeah, so we started the Leg Up Legal Virtual Coffee Club as a LinkedIn group that people could join to set up one-on-one coffee chats with other people in the LinkedIn group. And I saw a lot of success with it at the beginning, but then I think we kind of dropped off for a little bit. So I'm trying to think of ways to revitalize it actually in 2021. So we'll probably be doing more activity in that group soon. And maybe that's merging it with the virtual happy hour so that at least, you know, every other week, everyone gets to interact together. You know, one of the things we realized very quickly, especially with our mentoring program, is because all of our mentoring program is designed to be one-to-one. So it's one student matched with one attorney. And we noticed that people were craving community, not just having one other person to rely on, while that's extremely important too. They wanted to be able to interact with lots of other people. They wanted to still feel like they were part of a community. And I think that's what a lot of these students feel like they're missing in law school right now. If their law schools aren't giving them a lot of opportunities to bond with each other, they're missing that community. So that's why we created things like the virtual happy hours. And so maybe that's what we need to do, is combine the virtual coffee club with the happy hour so that people can not only meet each other one-on-one, but also have the happy hour to meet everyone.
Yeah, I agree that it seems like we are so alone for such a long time now, right? So the one-on-one is so great because you really get to know someone and you really might get future advice and tips from that person because now you know them. But yeah, there's something also for community. And it's hard to know, you know, everyone has their own community, their school or their, you know, family or friends, whatever. But yeah, a professional community is always, I mean, that's the whole point of, you know, the pre-law societies and the Phi Alpha Delta and all that kind of stuff, is that people want community. And so, yeah, that may be, yeah. Because like I said, I know the virtual happy hour was fantastic. So,
yeah, you know, it's interesting because during the early days of COVID, like in March and April, some of my students were telling me, you know, hey, Angie, I wasn't even able to move home. I'm stuck in my dorm room. I haven't talked to a single soul for 3 weeks. You know, I mean, I need human interaction. And, you know, and I think that that's when I realized, okay, maybe we need to do some more group events and not just one-on-one events. So during the summer, for a bunch of people who are entering law school, we hosted a virtual legal career boot camp, which we are actually planning on doing again this summer. And it was for all incoming 1Ls and rising 2Ls. And we also had a few 3Ls show up too, but we had over 90 speakers of attorneys who came in and talked about different career paths, mental health strategies, stress management, time management, you know, things. It was all focused on career development though. We didn't do any of the academic stuff. So there's no, you know, how to outline or how to take a law school exam. We didn't do any of that stuff because there's plenty of that already out there with Barbary Law Preview and Kaplan's programs and Quimby. So instead, what we really wanted to focus on was getting people to actually meet practitioners. You know, we wanted you to be able to connect with attorneys and match a face to the profession and see what some of these practice areas that you think you know what they're like are really like. I had a lot of students that thought they were interested in entertainment law because they think it's a certain thing. But then we had a panel of entertainment lawyers talk about what they actually do. And those students said, oh, maybe this isn't what I thought it is, you know? So it's really important that the students have opportunities to connect with lots of attorneys while they're still exploring what type of career path might be right for me.
That's great. How long does the session last?
So actually, I had no idea how many attorneys would volunteer for it. So initially, we thought it was going to be a 1 to 2 day event. It ended up being a 2 week boot camp with sessions from 9 to 5 every day. And I thought for sure we would lose everyone on Zoom because I was like, I don't think people will stay on that long every day. But we ended up, you know, people loved it. Like we left the Zoom room open during the lunch hour. People would just hang out and get to know people from law schools all around the state.
Well, that's so great that you guys did that last summer. I mean, and that you're doing it again this summer. That is fantastic. And it's very much needed. Students really have no clue.
And it's all free, by the way. It was all free. So we're talking about getting law firm sponsors this year, but we didn't have any sponsors last year and we were still able to host the entire thing for free for 2 weeks. So we're hoping to do that again this year.
And that's great too, because a lot of times the tips are really just the practical stuff, like how to take an exam, and that's out there. It's already out there. So it's great to have this other side, the other practical side that they need to know. I mean, this is what you're investing in. So
yeah. All the time. They should be running 2 tracks. You should be learning how to get into law school. So yeah, you should be learning how to take the LSAT, learning how to write a personal statement, learning how to write a diversity statement. But the other track that you should be running right alongside it is career exploration. You should be talking to lawyers. You should be learning about lots of different possible career paths. Because if you pick certain practice areas that are very niche, then it might completely change your choice of law school that you want to go to. For example, I picked intellectual property law. I'm a trademark and copyright lawyer. I talked to dozens of lawyers before going to law school to figure out that that was what I was interested in. And then once I decided that, one of the intellectual property lawyers that I spoke to was a hiring manager at a big law firm. And he asked me which law schools I was planning on applying to. And I gave him my list. I was going to apply to the T14, you know, the top tier law schools that everybody thinks they're the top tier because US News and World Report says so. Right. And he told me, Angie, this isn't going to work. We don't hire from these schools. You know, we do on-campus interviewing at 8 schools. And he gave me the list of 8, and only one of those was on my list. And I was shocked. I was floored. And so last minute, I took his list. I applied to all of those schools. And this was late in the game. It was like February when I talked to him. And luckily, because those schools were lower ranked overall, but better ranked in IP, not only did I get in, I got great scholarship offers. So, you know, it might really change your strategy in what law schools you end up applying to if you pick a super niche practice area like intellectual property or like entertainment law or, you know, something that's going to be, it's more advantageous for you to go to the specialized schools. Now, if you pick something very broad, like corporate, business, you know, criminal law, there's probably dozens of law schools that you could go to that will give you a sound legal education. Yeah. But it may really change your strategy depending on what practice areas you're interested in. So you definitely should be talking to practitioners because your life as an entertainment lawyer will be loads different than your life as a criminal law lawyer. I'll tell you that. And you got to figure out what's going to be right for you so that you can make the right choices on, you know, what you're applying to and how you're going to get scholarships to these schools. I mean, it impacts everything.
It really does. And I've talked to students specifically about that, choosing between a higher ranked school and a school with a specialty. And, you know, and sometimes it goes both ways because it just depends on what's important to them. Again, do they want to focus on that specialty or do they want to focus on that specialty? But there's other factors that actually do lead them to that other school. You know, it's always interesting, but you need to talk, yes, to people in the industry and really figure out and talk to people at the schools. Do you like your school? Do they actually provide what they promise? I mean, what's going on at the schools as well? So, and, you know, and to students, not the law school counselors, because they just want to sell their school. You know, they just want all the students, right? So
Like, listen, if you're talking to admissions counselors, yeah, sure, that's great. But of course, they're going to say our school is the best school that's ever existed. You know, I mean, it's your job. So, you know, talk to the actual students, talk to the alumni, talk to those folks and see if they felt like they're getting their money's worth. You know, yeah. I think it's really important.
Now, you also do a podcast, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So what's the name of your podcast?
So our podcast is the Law Lives Project, and it's about the early career paths of real lawyers. And in order to allow people to be very candid about the really difficult parts of their early careers, we decided to make the podcast anonymous. So you don't get to know exactly who the lawyers are, but you benefit from hearing their stories. And, you know, we've had lawyers come on and talk about failing the bar exam. We've had lawyers talk about getting fired from their first job. We've had lawyers talk about facing discrimination at work and being penalized for having children and all sorts of things. But I think it's all the stuff that people don't necessarily want to talk about if they're afraid that their employer might retaliate or like one of their past colleagues or coworkers may know that they're saying those things about them. And so we decided to keep it anonymous, but it's really allowed people to open up and share very raw and candid stories about the practice, really. So I think it's really important for students to hear those things because you don't learn from hearing about everyone's successes. You learn from by hearing about how did you overcome this big challenge in your life.
Okay.
Yeah. I think the last things we haven't covered is our LinkedIn post series. So we do a number of post series to allow people to connect with lawyers on LinkedIn and to get tips about their legal careers. So if you follow the hashtag Real Lawyers of LinkedIn, that is our post series where we feature a new lawyer that I've spoken to on LinkedIn every single week. We actually have two a week. So all of these lawyers are people who want to be able to connect with other people. So you can reach out to them, follow them, tell them that you saw them on the series, and they're happy to connect with you. So we did this in order to feature lawyers that were already creating great content on LinkedIn that I thought would be really valuable for students to see so they can follow them or connect with them. And then we also do the post series called The Juris Mentor. So hashtag Juris Mentor. And it's basically just tips and tricks that you'll need in your careers. Everything from how to take notes to how to prepare for interviews to timekeeping, you know, all sorts of tips and tricks. So follow those hashtags so that you can get that great information.
Those are both really great themes, just mentoring and tips. It's the whole package right there. That's so great that you do so much.
Thank you. Oh my gosh. Yeah, I want to talk about the mentoring program that we have. So the whole goal of me creating Leg Up Legal was not only to enable myself to be able to find mentees that I could help and work with, I also wanted other lawyers to be able to find mentees that they could work with because I knew a lot of lawyers that wanted to mentor, but they didn't have a lot of time to go cultivate those relationships. And once they were matched with their mentees, they didn't always know exactly where to start, what to help them with. Some mentees come to you just as a blank slate and they're like, teach me everything you know. And that can be a lot of high pressure for the lawyer because they're not sure what you feel like you're missing. So I think it's really important to be able to have a framework that you can work within and to have some sort of environment where you have committed to each other and you understand that you're now in this relationship and you're committed to meeting regularly and you're trying to accomplish specific things. I think that the reason that a lot of mentoring programs fail is because they focus so much on the matching piece. And then after their match, they just say, okay, good luck, go forth and mentor. And that's really awkward for a lot of people because they don't really know where to start those relationships. You know, I think about mentoring relationships a lot like dating relationships. You know, if you meet somebody on an app and you're going out on your first date, it can be really intimidating to think about what to say to that person. It's the same with mentoring. I mean, people don't think about it that way, but they should because anybody who's had a mentoring meeting with a mentor that they've been matched with in a formal mentoring program has probably gone through that anxiety of like, what do I say to this person? And so our mentoring program was really meant to provide a curriculum that allows people to meet with each other, identify what do they want to work on, and then
actually accomplish those goals by meeting regularly. So we use technology to enable all of those things. So our mentoring program is 100% virtual. There's no in-person meetings, which was great for COVID. And basically it works like a dating app. You get onto the mentoring app, you create a profile, you're able to search through the mentor profiles of all the active mentors in the active pool, and you can pick the person that you want to talk to, and you hit match. And then once you hit match, it unlocks all of the communication features. So you're able to do chat and, you know, do text messages back and forth with your mentor. You're also able to schedule meetings and do video chat inside of the app. So we have a Zoom-like video chat inside the app. So all of your meetings happen through that, the app. And then your mentor is able to assign you goals and milestones that you have to meet to get to those overarching goals. And they can also provide you feedback. There's like a feedback tracker where you can rate your mentee, you know, 1 to 5 on different assignments they perform to you. There's also learning materials that we have, a learning library that they can assign to their mentees. So if you think that there's a certain assignment in our learning library that you want to have them do, like learn about bar associations by, you know, watching these modules, you can assign those things to your mentee and they can do those before your next meeting. So everything's meant to be facilitated by the technology. And the app will also remind you if you haven't met with your mentor in a while, so that it will make up for the fact that, yes, listen, you know, we get it. Law students and pre-law students, they get busy. Lawyers get busy. You're going to forget. Like, that is totally normal and totally human. And we know that. And so, you know, the app is really meant to provide that gentle nudge to tell you to keep on going with your relationships so that you can keep benefiting from them, because it's going to happen. And if you are in any sort of mentoring program where you don't have technology to facilitate it, you have to create those things yourself, set your own calendar reminders to meet with your mentor, whatever it is. But we wanted to create all of that structure so that the mentors and mentees in our program don't have to worry about that. So we give you a career development plan. It has two parts. There's self-driven objectives and then mentoring objectives. The self-driven objectives help pre-law students identify what do they already know about the legal profession and what do they not know. And once you figure out what are the key pieces you're missing, then you can choose mentoring objectives that align with those to help you discover those things with your mentor. And so if you realize, oh, I actually don't know what are all the practice areas out there, and I want to be able to explore this specific practice area with my mentor, that can be one of your learning objectives. And your mentor will assign you milestones. Maybe they'll do assignments with you, walk you through what they would give their interns or something like that, so that you can learn more about the substantive practice area. And so that's basically what we do. And I'm actually matched with 3 mentees in our program. Every mentor can match with up to 3 mentees, but each mentee can only match with 1 mentor at a time. So the goal is, though, to be able to work with many different people. So after you accomplish 3 objectives with your mentor, you can decide, hey, is this relationship working? Do I like this person? Do I want to keep going with this person? Or do I really want to just go back into the active pool, find another mentor, and learn from another person? So all of those things can happen. You know, if you want to keep working with the same mentor, you can. If you want to work with a different mentor, you can. So I've had all 3 of my mentees for about 6 months now, and we've renewed once, but they can choose to go back into the pool anytime that they want.
So then, for example, if they feel like they've learned a lot from you, but then they want to learn something a little more specific or in a different area, and they feel like maybe somebody else might give them a different perspective on that, then they just would go back in the pool?
Exactly. You just hit unmatch and they go back into the pool, and then they can search from all the active mentors again. And you can always, you know, keep in touch with your mentors even after you're unmatched with them. You can, once you get to know each other well, you can exchange emails, or you can, you know, exchange LinkedIns and connect on LinkedIn, whatever you want to do to stay in touch. But we do encourage people at the start not to exchange personal identifying information like emails and phone numbers, just in case it's not really the greatest match. So, you know, I mean, always use caution when you're doing these things, but we do vet all of the mentors, we do vet all of the mentees. And so, you know, we want everybody to have a really good quality experience in the program.
So. That's great. Now, does this program cost money, or how does it work?
Yeah, so usually we go and partner with pre-law advisors at undergraduate universities. The pre-law advisors sign a pilot up of maybe 20 students or so, and they'll get access for an entire year for free through their school. So the school pays for it, the students get it for free. If you don't happen to go to one of our partner institutions where the pre-law advisor has signed up with us, then you can subscribe on your own for $19.99 a month. So it's just basically like a dating app. You pay, you know, monthly subscription, you get access to all the same things that everyone else gets. So you get access to the same mentoring pool, the same curriculum, all of it.
Wow, that's great. How many schools are you guys at so far?
So we're at three.
Okay, that's great. That is great.
Yeah, so we're at three universities, and we've been growing. You know, during COVID, a lot of people have been realizing that they don't have these technology solutions to help facilitate their mentoring programs. So we're basically a plug-and-play mentoring solution for undergraduate universities, and also for law firms. You know, we just actually signed our first law firm partnership. So that we have dedicated mentors from that firm on the platform. And before then, you know, I was going out, and whenever I would talk to any attorneys on LinkedIn or anywhere else, I would invite them into our program. So we already had about 60 volunteer mentors that were just within my network. And then we've just been trying to grow that as fast as possible. So we've started working with law firms and bar associations to see if we can set up more structured mentoring programs to be able to have more of their attorneys join our mentoring program.
That's fantastic, because I know that getting more than one perspective or one advisor is great, but obviously focusing so that you actually accomplish something and get something done and you're on a path needs to be done. But as far as long-term, yeah, you know, if you hear from just one person, sometimes you get a very skewed perspective. They're mad about something, right? Or they're just...
I had some attorneys tell me before going to law school, just don't do it. You know, I had some attorneys that were like, it's not worth it. Don't do it. Don't dig yourself in a mountain of debt. And then I had other attorneys who were like, oh yeah, best decision of my life. You know, I mean, I think it, your experiences will vary a lot, and you need to hear from lots of different types of people. And I always tell my mentees that, listen, take what I say with a grain of salt, but go out and live it yourself and see if these things work for you. And if they don't work for you, I want you to tell me. I want you to let me know, because it helps me improve the experience for other people when I give them advice. So, you know, I mean, I think that we all do our best to provide the best advice that we can, but yeah, we can't anticipate everything that's out there.
No, like you said, you would have never had any idea that you shouldn't be going to the school you wanted to go to, that you were planning to go to. And you know, it's hard. And I think any normal advisor would probably say, yeah, go to that school.
But I think a pre-law advisor would have said, sure, go to Columbia, go to Yale, go to, if you can get in, go. You know, I think they would have easily said that.
Yeah, I think that that's where services like what you do and what I do as well. We're in between the pre-law advisors and the law school counselors, and we're filling that gap. And you're doing it so well, because it's really necessary that, you know, the pre-law advisors have a lot of technical advice. You know, here's the rankings. Here's what you got to do. You need to update your resume. You need to take the LSAT.
And I point all of my students to their pre-law advisors. I always tell pre-law advisors, I think that what we do is actually very complimentary, because I stay completely out of all the LSAT prep game, all of the application prep stuff. I mean, that is their bread and butter. So I always tell my students, once you start getting into the application cycle and you need to know about how to write a law school application, go talk to your pre-law advisor. But while you're still in exploration mode, you know, come participate in our program. Or if you've already gotten accepted to law school and now you need to know what the heck you're about to get into, then come and participate in our program. You know, I think that those two tracks, they run alongside each other. Like, there's not one that comes before the other. The academic track doesn't necessarily come before the career exploration, and not vice versa either. You should be doing both. So, you know, you don't know when you're going to need the career development stuff, but I think that that's usually what gets pushed to the wayside, because they're so focused on the academic stuff. They're so focused on how do I actually get into law school. Which I totally understand. That's very, very important. But equally important is figuring out, do I actually want to be a lawyer at the end of the day? Because you're about to sign up for, you know, a career path. Like, that is what law school is. Law school is not meant for people who want to just figure out, what the heck do I want to do with my life? it's not exactly the best mechanism for doing that because you're digging yourself into a mountain of debt while you're doing that. If you are still, you know, thinking that, oh, maybe I want to be an engineer or an astronaut or something like that, law school is not where you will figure that out. Law school is where you're going to figure out, do I want to be a lawyer? And you better figure it out fast. So try to figure that out, at least get a sense of what different types of lawyers exist and what types of practice areas you may be interested in before you get into law school, because you're going to get into law school in August. The earliest time that you can start applying for internships is in December. You don't have any grades back. You don't have nothing. And from August to December, you're busy trying to learn how to law school. Like, that's all you care about. And so you don't know, you know, you don't have time to think about all these other career paths or what type of lawyer do I want to be, or you know, all of that type of thing. So try to figure that out beforehand.
That's so good. Angie, you are so full of so much great information, and you're providing so much value to these students who really need it. And like you said, sometimes completely miss this aspect. They're so busy on their little checklist. That's a super important checklist, but it's just a checklist, and it doesn't deal with the entire other half of what they're going to be doing. So I'm just so glad you're out there. I'm so glad you're doing all these services for these students.
Thank you.
Yeah, I definitely want you to be sharing your app in my Facebook group. I want that. Yes, I want them. They've been asking for mentoring. I've been trying to work it up, but you've got it going. So share that in the group.
Yeah, definitely. We'll do.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining me today. If people want to reach out to you, how can they do that?
They're welcome to connect with me on LinkedIn, or I'm happy to circulate my email to you and you can send it out to your folks. LinkedIn, I'm on every single day. So feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn, and I look forward to chatting with you.
Thanks. Okay. Before we get into my top takeaways, a quick word from our sponsor, Juno. If you need to take out student loans, check in with Juno first. Juno can often offer law students 1% to 2% lower interest rates than the federal government, and not only with no cost to the student, but oftentimes with cash back as well. Visit joinjuno.com/p/podcast/LegalLearningCenter for more information. My top takeaways from this chat with Angie. First, prospective law students should use their pre-law advisor for application assistance. They should use LegUp Legal for mentoring and career advising. The two go side by side. They don't necessarily overlap. You should use both. Number two, networking doesn't have to be hard or scary. Check out the Zoom happy hours that LegUp Legal offers. They are a lot of fun, and they are a great way to hone some of those networking skills. And then number three, if you want a candid discussion of what it's like to practice law, the ins and outs and ups and downs, check out her podcast, Law Lives Project. That's it for this episode. All tips, links, and so forth will be in the show notes. A full transcript will be available at legallearningcenter.com/LegUpLegal. And be sure to tune in next week when we talk to Dave Strasberg. Dave is an expert at informational interviews and will tell you how you can use them to improve your job prospects and expand your network. Now, if you learned something today, please like, share, comment, subscribe, so that this show is more visible to those who may need it. Thanks.